chapter 2, verse, I'm going to start from verse 11. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of the assembly. I will sing praises to you. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and release those who, through fear of death, were all their lifetime subject to bondage. So, first of all, it says that Jesus wasn't ashamed to call us his brothers and sisters, and he's able to call us that because he became like us when he stooped down to our level and became human. We had the same father, and he calls us his brothers, and because of that, he was able to defeat Satan's power over death and deliver us from death and free us to live for him. But he didn't just come to save us from death and go back to heaven and that's it. He, in verse 16 to 18, for indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. So because he became like us and he suffered, he's able to help us, and he's able to understand us, and he has a personal relationship with each one of us. And that's how I know that the word is alive, because he's able to speak to us about something that's very specific to each one of us, and it's an amazing feeling when he does that, because the Bible is written like thousands of years ago, and it still applies to us today. And I just encourage each one of you guys to have that personal relationship with God, where he's able to speak to you about something very specific to you, or what situation that you're going through. And something else that proves the validity of the word is David in Psalm chapter 22, verse 22. He prophesied that Jesus would call us his brothers. I will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of the assembly. I will praise you. And that's the same exact verse as verse 12 here in Hebrews. David probably didn't even understand really what he was writing when he wrote that, because that was way before Jesus actually called us his brothers. And it just shows that the Bible is the inspired word of God, and it's an amazing feeling when you read it and you know that he knows what you're going through, and he is able to speak to you very personally. And that's it.
Amen. Praise the Lord that Jesus is our brother. He calls us brethren, and that's huge, that his love, he is God, and yet he considers us his brethren. But not just that, he was tested in everything, and he says this is why he can help us and give us aid. You know, imagine if you were going to have knee surgery. And then you come to me as a doctor and I share with you, you know, here's how you're going to feel and here's how it is and here's the recovery or even the surgeon. That could mean something. But if you talk to Bibo, he could probably tell you, and you probably believe Bibo way over me because he's been through it, right? Because he was tested and he went through it, it's much different than intellectually knowing about it than experiencing it. And Jesus said, I came and I experienced it, like Johnny shared with us. And he says, that's why I can help you and kind of have a personal touch, a personal relationship with you. So let's open up 1 Corinthians chapter 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. And don't feel shy to come forward and come close so we can encourage each other. And if I can have Jimmy come read it for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. 1 Corinthians 8, come forward. Come on, the Farugs. Come on, please.
Now concerning things offered to idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. And if anyone thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, this one is known by him. Therefore, concerning the eating of things offered to idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is no other God but one. For even there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as there are many gods and many lords. Yet for us there is one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we for him and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and lived whom we live. However, there is not in everyone that knowledge. For some with consciousness of the idol until now eat it as a thing offered to an idol, and their conscience being weak and is defiled. But food does not commend us to God, for neither we, if we eat, are we the better, nor if we do not eat, are the worse. But beware lest somehow this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to those who are weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will not the conscience of him who is weak be emboldened to eat those things offered to idols? And because of your knowledge shall the weak brother perish, for whom Christ died. But when you thus sin against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. Therefore, the food makes my brother stumble. I will never again eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble.
Amen. Thank you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time that you've given us, and we thank you for every amazing opportunity that we can come worship you, the God of the universe, the God who created us, the God who's given us life and who's made salvation possible. We come and we thank you, and we desire, as we sang in the songs, to be close to you. And we come to you, Jesus, as we just heard that, just humbled by you calling us brethren, and you calling us to come to you because you have compassion and you are able to help us in time of need. We pray that we would understand what that means and how amazing that is, and that we don't let this opportunity of coming to you anytime, anywhere, knowing that you are able to personally be there for us and help us. We pray for anointing on the words we just read, that you might minister and speak to our hearts in this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Before we talk, I want to tell you this section in Corinthians is really cool. In chapter 8, chapter 9, and chapter 10, it talks about balance. Balance in our spiritual walk. And it's really important to not just have one thing. We can have something really good, and we could take it too far, and then it doesn't become very good. So he says, listen, when you have something, you have to be balanced. You have to know what you're doing. And this applies to many things. For example, let's say someone is likes to exercise. I'll tell you, when I was in college, so I happened to get the privilege to be friends with the biggest guy on the football team. Really huge guy. He was benching 5-something. That's like what he works out with. The guy's huge. Whenever we'd walk next to each other, you can't see me from how big he is. But the thing about him, though, he is, and he's not, you know, fat. He is all solid muscles. But the other thing, he had balance, though. Even though he was buff and he ate a lot to be able to keep up with the metabolism, but he was really buff. But the other thing that was really weird is he's really fast. I think he was the fastest guy on the football team, which is very hard to find. Usually football players, you either find the big guys that will go tackle, or you find the small guys and they're the ones that go really fast. And he had both. And he was a machine. You know, you can't stand in front of this guy. And he had that flexibility. Yet, because you can get really big and become really bulky, and you walk like this, you can't even like bend, you know, so what use is that, right? And so he had that ability and that balance. So he says, listen, when you live a Christian life, or even if God calls you to do something specific, you have to be balanced. Don't let it get to your head. You need to be really, really balanced. So for example, chapter 9 talks about if you have authority, authority must be balanced with something. Or else it's very dangerous. And here he's talking in a spiritual sense. If you have authority, it must be balanced with discipline. So if God is going to put you over a group of people to lead them and have authority, if you don't know how to have self-discipline, don't lead them. Because you'll be a dictator, it's going to be crazy. It's going to be really, really unbalanced and not healthy for the group that you're leading. Chapter 10, the first half, talks about if you have experience. So you've been walking with God for a while, and you know God has given you victory and victory and victory and victory. He says, yes, experience can get to your head. Experience actually must be balanced with something else. He says it must be balanced with caution. Don't rely on your experience. You still have to continually rely on your God. And then the second half of Corinthians is a big topic that is many times in Christianity, we don't have balance in, and that's liberty, freedom that we have in God. He says, even the freedom that we have must be balanced or it goes too far. And he says, the freedom that we have, yes, we have freedom in Christ. He has freed us, and we are free, and we can just live and do things, but even the freedom has to be balanced. And the freedom has to be balanced that we live responsibly. It must be balanced with responsibility. I can't just foolishly live that freedom because then I become a slave and I'm no longer living in the freedom. I must walk in that freedom with responsibility, responsibly. It must be balanced with that. Our topic, chapter 8, he says knowledge also could be very dangerous if not balanced. And he says if you want to do knowledge right, it must be balanced with love. And that's what is on my heart to share with you guys at this time. So we must walk a balanced life. And this happens, like I said, even if you're exercising, if you want to achieve something, you must be balanced in what you do. You can't, you know, exercise all the time and not get rest, not get the right nutrients. That's not healthy. It's not a good balance. Even, I'll share with you guys a personal thing. I had a struggled a lot, and I praise God for my wife, with a balance. You know, I'm a physician. But then I became physician in charge of a building and then two buildings. And then, so I'm a physician in charge, I'm a husband, and I am a father. And I had a very difficult time finding that balance. Because if all you do is live for your work, well, how about where are you as a husband and where are you as a father? And how do you, that's not balanced. And it took me a lot, and I praise God again, like I said, for my wife, she's helped me a lot, and I still struggle with it, but she helps me with that. So we must be balanced in order to live a healthy life in anything, in everything, and especially in the Christian walk. And the Christian walk is much more complex because there's many aspects to it, right? God gives you authority with certain people, but that must be balanced. You have to have discipline. You have to discipline your body that things don't get to your head or it becomes pride. So here we're going to talk about 1 Corinthians chapter 8, very short chapter. I'm going to spend a little bit of time, and we will go from there. So 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1. Now concerning things offered to idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. Now, just before, you know, you're like, what is this talking about? This is not applicable to me, right? Anyone here feels this is, what did I just read? How about this? Let's just make sure we're all awake. What did I read? What is the topic here at hand? Don't tell me knowledge. I know we're talking about knowledge, but what is the topic? Any ideas? Knowledge about what? Idols, right? So things sacrificed to idols specifically, right? So idols is correct, but it's the specific topics, things sacrificed to idols. Does anyone here know anybody who sacrifices things to idols that you actually know personally? Not that you think it knows or you know it happened somewhere, but that you actually know somebody who sacrifices things to idols? Anyone? Raise your hand. Okay, raise your hand if you don't know anybody who sacrifices things to idols. Some people didn't raise their hand. I think they're asleep. I don't know anybody who sacrifices things to idols, right? It's not a common thing in today's thing. So I was like, what is this message about? Is this applicable to us? It actually is very applicable. Because you can apply this to other things. For example, let me not give it the example of how it applies, but let me just talk a little bit. So here he's saying, listen, concerning things offered to idols, well, let me explain what that means. What is the dilemma and why do they even have an issue? He's saying, listen, do you guys know what people offered to idols back in the days? What did they offer to idols? Food, okay? Any specific type of food that was the common thing that they offered? Are the idols vegetarian? Are they pescatarian? Are they vegans? Are they, what are they? Any ideas? What was like the main thing you offer to idols? Meat, right? Meat is like the main meal that the idols like. So you sacrifice idols to idols, you sacrificed meat. Well, raise your hand just to make sure. Anybody here likes meat? I like meat. Okay, you like steak? Steak is good. So here he's saying, listen, if you go buy a piece of steak from the market, from the supermarket, it is expensive. Steak is expensive. Did you guys know that? I know most of you guys, you know, someone cooks for you, but steak is expensive. And so he says, listen, if you go to the supermarket, it's expensive. But there's another place that has a very high supply of steak, of meat, and there's lots of it, and that is idols. If you go to a place where they worship idols, they have lots of, because they're killing animal after animal, and every person brings in an animal, so there's lots of steak left over. So guess what? They start selling it. So do you think they sell it for expensive or for cheap? Cheap. It's cheaper than the supermarket. So you like steak. And because you like steak, you want to go eat steak. Now, do you think, well, let me ask you this. The nutritional value of the steak that is in the supermarket and the nutritional value of the steak that was sacrificed to an idol, has there been like a change in their calories, in the composition, in anything like that? Or is it still the same nutritional value? The same nutritional value. So one steak is $10. The other one is $5. Which one are you going to go buy? Huh? The $10 one? You just like the expensive stuff. No, but seriously, like what would you do? Would you even consider, so you're a Christian, and you know that the $5 one is just as good as the $10 one. It's exactly the same nutritionally, exactly the same in every way. It is half price, but you know it was sacrificed to an idol. So what are you going to do? You want to eat steak. You really want to eat steak. Which one are you going to buy? You might buy the $10 one, right? Because it's at the supermarket. But at the same time, something's bugging you. Like, I could have saved 50% off, right? If you don't even buy it, it's at least going to cross your mind, should I buy it or not, right? Or no? Would it even be a thought? Or you're just like, no, sacrifice idols. I don't know. I'll tell you. I'll think about it. So here Paul says, listen, now concerning things offered to idols, we know that we all have knowledge. And here he's talking we. Who is we? Who is he considering? If you have to be really specific, who's the we? Help me out. We're going to preach together. Who's we? No ideas, huh? The Corinthians? So if it's, is it only the Corinthians? Huh? Believers? Yes. So Corinthian believers, I'll take that. But then how about, would that be you or would that be we? Huh? You or we, if he's writing only, if he's only including Corinthians? Would be you, right? So we includes what? At least him, right? We? No. So we, he's writing to the Corinthians, so the Corinthians, believers, and himself. He says, we all have knowledge. Now I want you to know that the Corinthians, they don't have like normal knowledge, a normal knowledge of the Word of God. These guys have like really, really, really good knowledge. That's why he's hitting them up with this. They had many spiritual diseases, yet they had so much spiritual blessings from God. So watch, open this 1 Corinthians chapter 1, right in the beginning, right when he starts. And look at verse 5. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 5. It says that you were enriched in everything. Whoa, that's a lot, right? Imagine you're enriched, and you're enriched in what? Everything. And he says, oh, I'll tell you who made you rich. By him, capital H, by God. So God enriched you in everything. And then he got really specific, in all utterance. When it comes to speaking, you're very rich. You speak really well, and you speak the right words, and you know how to speak about God. In all utterance, but not just that, and all knowledge. So here, the one who enriched you and gave you the ability to have the knowledge that you have was God himself miraculously gave you this knowledge to know it. You know, there's two different types of people who have knowledge of the Word of God. There's some that have knowledge of the Word of God on an intellectual level. And they are literature type stuff. They look at the Word of God. They can analyze it, and they can, you know, they know what's where and what's what and all these things. But they're only intellectual. They cannot, no matter how deep, what kind of a PhD they have, they cannot get the depth that any of us in this room who are believers can get compared to them. So someone with a PhD in Bible who is not a believer can defeat any of us in knowledge of what's written in the Word of God by quoting it and where it is and how it was written and what time it was written and all these things. But when it comes to really understanding the Word of God, they fall short next to every single one in this room, all of us who are believers, because we have an edge on them. You know what the edge is? The Holy Spirit. Reading the Word of God by the Holy Spirit is a whole other taste, is something very different. And the Corinthians, they received miraculously the knowledge of the Word of God given to them by Jesus. Now they fully understand the Word of God, I would say probably better than me for sure. They know it supernatural way through the Holy Spirit, knowing the Word of God. He says, good that you know that, but I want you to know you're using it wrong, Corinthians. I need you to use it the right way. He says, we know that we all have knowledge. You guys have it, and so do I, because the knowledge I have is through the Holy Spirit, and I know the Word of God has been given to me as a gift from God. And there's a special gift about knowing the Word of God and understanding it through the Holy Spirit. And there's a general for all of us, and there's a special gift for some people. And he says, knowledge puffs up. You know what puffs up mean? Can get your head, can give you pride. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. But if you have love, you can edify, which means you can build the person up, be an encouragement to that person, be a blessing to that person that you are sharing the knowledge with. He says, listen, knowledge could be a great weapon, but knowledge could also be a great tool. So if you use it as a weapon, you've destroyed people. But if you use it as a tool, you've built up people. So he says, listen, Corinthians, don't flex your spiritual knowledge, but use it to help others and help them on their way and on their path. What is he talking about? I'll tell you just very, this basically summarizes the chapter. I'll tell you what he's talking about to understand what the issue is. He says, listen, let's think now from a logical perspective. How many true gods are out there? True gods, not claimed to be gods. How many true gods are out there? Thank you. One, right? Now, if someone claims, now how many gods are out there, whether true or not true? How many gods are out there? Many. You can't count. I don't know. There's too many, right? Like you can name certain religions and certain things, but then I don't know. And even some of them have a lot. So there's a lot of out there. Now, if I claim that this is a god, did that make this thing a god? Like for a true god or no? No, right? To you, it's like, it's a water bottle, man. But to someone, maybe to someone's like, oh, water bottle, you know, let me. It doesn't change the fact that it's still what? Not a true God, right? He says, okay, so let's use our head, man. If there's really no other true gods out there, okay, and we agree, you have knowledge and so do I. Therefore, if I come and I say, you know what, I have a piece of steak, but I need you to know something. When I killed it and I sacrificed it, I prayed to this water bottle. And I worshipped it. And then I cut it and I have the piece of steak. Did the piece of steak change its nutritional value? We agreed that no. Okay, is this thing a true God or no? We agree that it's not a true God. Can I have the piece of steak, please? Let me eat it. It's cheaper. Let me just eat the piece of steak. He says, knowledge tells you it's ridiculous. There's no true gods out there. You should be able to just go out there and eat the piece of steak. He says, you have knowledge and I have knowledge. He says, but that, you have to weigh that knowledge against something else because you have to balance that knowledge with love. Let me ask you, let me apply this a little bit to make it be understandable. Going to the theater, movie theater, right or wrong? It depends on what you're watching. So did you hear that? So say there's a movie, The Passion of the Christ, courageous, war room, right? Christian, really like solid Christian room. Christian movies, right? So, and it's playing at the movie theater. And you go watch it at the movie theater. Right or wrong to go to the movie theater? Right, and I see a thumbs up. Okay, now let's say there's a movie that has violence, nudity, profanity playing at the movie theater. Right or wrong to go watch it? So I see a thumbs down. Okay, let's get real. How many, don't raise your hand, but how many really go watch that stuff? Right? So it's not the building. It's what's being played. Right? You have knowledge. Now, there's some Christians that the word theater to them equals sin. Right? To you, it's like, that's silly. It's what's being played at the theater. You have what? Knowledge. So do you see, it can apply to us to many things today. That you're like, wait a minute. Let me bring it, and let me give you another example to make it applicable. Drinking alcohol. Not getting drunk. Drinking alcohol. Right or wrong? Huh? Right? Okay. So right. So, for example, if we won't say who, but the person who said right, if this person drinks a little bit and is seen by the police in America, right or wrong, you're going to be in big trouble, right? Even though if my mom let me or my dad let me, what's it called? Underage. Now, okay, so let's take out the part of underage out. Okay, I'm being silly. I'm just teasing. Trying to wake you guys up. So let's say you're 21 years old. And you want to drink one drink of alcohol, and You want to just, you're not going to get drunk. You're not going to drink another drink. You're not even going to get buzzed. You just want one drink of alcohol, and you're 21 years old, so it's legal in America. Is it okay or not? Right or wrong? Huh? Huh? It's okay. So knowledge says, the Bible says, listen, there's two clear things. Do not get drunk. Okay, I'm not going to get drunk. It says it's okay for medicine. Okay, it's not medicine. But I want to, it's not getting drunk. It doesn't say thou shalt not ever touch an alcohol. Right? It doesn't say that. There's no commandment that says that. Now, let me take it another step. There's some Christians, to them, drinking alcohol equals sin. Oh, well, this gets a little bit. So what I'm trying to share with you guys today is actually extremely relevant. And it is so essential that you could take weird topics that maybe you're like, you know, the Bible is not quite clear about this. Because movie theater, I can promise you, they didn't have it back in those days. But things along those lines to help guide you to make decisions and make the right decisions. So you have knowledge. And by the way, you guys, what you've answered is very mature and shows that you know biblical truths, which is very good. But there's a flip side that Paul wants to introduce to us is don't use that knowledge to flex muscles and then you're going to end up hurting other people. You have to look at the other balance is apply that. The application of this knowledge needs to be applied with love or else it's a problem. For example, imagine this. Like, I don't know if you've ever had somebody like you're struggling with a particular subject. And then so you want someone to help you, tutor you. And that person obviously has knowledge in that particular subject. Can you imagine if you go to that person who got the subject and their expectation is that you should just know this already? Okay, can you imagine that, right? So let's make me the bad tutor. Okay, so I'm the tutor. Okay, I taught when I was in Cal State Long Beach attending there. I taught a pre-calculus class to some of the students. I had my own class, 18 students. So as I was teaching them, and you get a pass-fail. So it's a credit, no credit class, and I think they give it one unit. And I attend with them their class. My goal is that they need to pass my class as credit, no credit, but they also get a grade in the other class, in the pre-calculus class that they're taking. And basically, my students were at-risk students, were like basically sports, people who are in sports, who are not doing so well, and they need to do well or else they're going to get kicked off the team. And then some other students who are struggling. Can you imagine me as their teacher, when I go there, and when I lecture to them, I had a 1.5 hour lecture twice a week. It was cool. I got paid for it. And then so you go and you're teaching them, and listen, you say, listen, dummies, you guys need to know pre-calculus. You guys went to the class. I went to the class. I get it. Y'all need to get it. Is that a good approach? No way. You know, then why are they in my class? It's because they're struggling. If someone comes to you for help with something that you have knowledge about and you expect them to know it, then why would they come to you if they know it? Right? Hello? Think, right? The same exact thing here. He says, listen, people, you who know the Word of God, you who love the Word of God, you who study the Word of God, don't get all like, oh, you dummies. What is wrong with you? Don't you know anything in the Word of God? And that's like, it's crazy, right? You gotta have love. One guy said something that I really love. He said, listen, love? Well, let me share with you one verse and then I'll apply it to both of these. And it kind of goes together. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 15. Ephesians 4, 15. But speaking the truth in love. So if I speak the truth in love, I could do something. May grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ. So it causes, if I speak to people the truth in love, I will grow, and the person I'm speaking the truth in love with them is going to grow, and we're going to grow, and we're looking like somebody. Grow up in all things, so you help that person grow in every aspect of their life, that we become what? Into him who is the head, Christ. We start to look like Jesus Christ. It's pretty awesome. But in order for me to help somebody and someone to help me get there, what do I need to do? I need two things. Did you guys pick up on them? What do I need to do? Huh? Any ideas? Speak the truth. Not speak a lie. But when I speak the truth is what I need to do it what? In love. So meaning, if someone comes to you and says, oh, you know, imagine this, okay? Let's say I'm coming to you like, I just keep sinning. And I want you to come help me, right? I keep sinning. And I just have this problem that I like to steal. And I stole again. And I feel bad, but I just can't stop stealing. And I come to you. And you want to encourage me, right? And so you come, oh, it's okay. Did you speak the truth to me with the word of God? It is not okay for me to steal, right? But if you come to me and you want to help me and you're like, you thief, I'm calling the police right now. I'm turning you in. And I can't even believe that you would even come and we would even have a conversation. Why do you even exist? Right? That is, so I told you that what you did is wrong, but in a non-loving way. Right? So you say, you know what, brother? What you did is wrong. But you know, God loves you and God can help you and God can free you. But you need to truly confess, not just feel sorry. Feeling sorry is not repentance. That's just your guilt, and you're going to, after a while, your conscience is going to die. You need to speak the truth in love. So one guy said, so speak the truth in love is the same thing as what? Having knowledge applied to other people, you use it with other people in love. Very important, because knowledge by itself, you guess what? You become proud. Knowledge puffs up. But love edifies. If I have knowledge and I apply it with love, I end up being a blessing to people. Same thing, truth can be a problem if all I do is truth. That can puff me up as well. One guy said, truth by itself, without love, is brutality. He says, but you got to look at the other end. Love by itself, without the truth, without knowledge, is hypocrisy. Because all you're doing is encouraging people and letting them live in sin and doing all that stuff. You've not been a blessing to anybody. You need both. If you want to be effective, if you want to be a blessing, you need to be a balanced Christian. You can't stick to where you're at and not have knowledge. You must have knowledge. But you can't let the knowledge get to your head that you become so arrogant. You need to balance it with love. You can't, if all you have is knowledge, it becomes a weapon. You destroy people. You call people names and you just put people down. But you must use it as a tool to be a blessing to people, so you must balance it with love. Then you become a blessing and you become one who edifies others. So let's spend 1 minute or so or less on each verse. Now concerning things offered to idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. And if anyone thinks that he knows anything, and here he's saying, listen, I just need you to know. So knowledge doesn't get to your head. If you think like you're the know-it-all and like nobody else knows anything than you, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. I want you to know that no matter how big your head can get, you're ignorant. You're ignorant when it comes to comparing your knowledge to what God really knows. So don't ever think that you've attained. Don't ever think that you've reached the ultimate. Don't ever think that, you know, I think I got this. He says, because see, the thing is, when it comes to the knowledge of God, when it comes to the knowledge of the Word of God, it's like what Isaiah did when he went into that. Did you guys remember that? So basically there was a leak. Sorry, not Isaiah, Ezekiel. So there was a leak in the temple from the Holy of Holies. There's a leak there from the holy place. And there's like water. He's like, whoa, wait a minute. So they went and traced it. And then they went, it's like, whoa. So what comes from the Holy of Holies is God's Word, okay, from a symbolic standpoint. So he took Ezekiel, he says, you know what, let's go. And I think it was 1,000 cubits. He's like, let's go in there a certain amount of distance. So he went in there and he found that the water is to the heels. He's like, I think I got this. You know, you're not afraid to drown, even if you don't know how to swim, when the water's to the heels. He's like, well, let's go a little deeper. So he goes a little deeper with him. And then the water now is to the knees. Still not scary. I think I got this. But the more he got to know God, it's like, you know, I don't know if this happened to you. It happened to me when I was a Christian. When I first became Christian, I'm like, oh, wow, I think I know the Bible. And you're like, okay, why? Because
You know, I know that, you know, Jesus raised Lazarus 4 days, you know. It's like, you think now you know the Bible because you know this information, because it's very simple for anyone to read. But then when you get deep into the Word of God, you're like, whoa, this is very complex. This is really, really amazing deep truths that we find in the Word of God. So then he goes and he's like, okay, now it's getting a little harder. He says, well, let's go a little deeper. And then the water got to the hips. He says, well, let's go a little bit more. And then he went a little bit more and he says, I'm swimming. I don't have, it's way above me. And then I look to see, well, maybe there I can attain. I said, well, maybe there's a shore somewhere where I could reach. He says that it is endless, the depth you have. He says, listen, when it comes to knowing the Word of God, you don't know it all. You will never know it all. No one will ever know it all. I don't care what title they have, the biggest, best, most knowledgeable pastor, whatever, theologian, doesn't know. No one, doesn't exist. He says, listen, you need to be humble when it comes to the Word of God. If anyone thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, this one is known by him. And the word known means you're approved by God. He says it's about love. He wants you to continue to go deeper and deeper and deeper like Ezekiel did. But as you go deeper, he wants you to also grow in something else. And that's the love. Love for God and love for others. If you love God, God says, amen, I'm going to give you more. And I'm going to reveal to you more. And I'm going to take you deeper into your walk with me. And you start to know more about God. Therefore, concerning the eating of things offered to idols. Let's get back to our topic, he says. We know that an idol is nothing in the world. It still is a water bottle. It's not truly an idol. And that there is no other God but one. You guys have already answered this. And I know because you know this chapter and you know the truth in the Word of God. For even if there are so-called gods, yeah, people call things gods, whether in heaven or on earth, right? So some people will look up like, oh, Venus, oh, that's a god. The sun, ooh. Some people worship the sun. Some people worship the moon. So whether in heaven or on earth, you know, people will make a tree their god, you know, an animal their god, things like that. As there are many gods and many lords, that's what people are calling. There's all kinds of things out there. Yet for us, there is one God. There's only one God, the Father of whom are all things, and we for him. He says, there's only one God. And he says, I want you to know this God. He's the Father. God the Father. I want you to know about God the Father, of whom are all things. You know of whom are all things what? He created us. He created everything that exists. So listen, Mr. or Ms. Knowledgeable. You need to know you are alive because he allows you to live. God the Father, of whom are all things. And he says, but I need you to go another step. And we for him. Do you know what this means? He says, I want you to know that I made you, but I made you for a purpose. And that purpose is for him, for God the Father. So you're supposed to live for who? For God. Did you know that you and I have a purpose? That's huge. You know, there was a real story that happened. So there was this this guy. Hopefully I don't mess up the story. But it was this one guy. He escaped. He was a prisoner. He escaped. Then he went and he got this lady. And basically he had her as a hostage. And, you know, the lady didn't know what to do. And so they were there. And then he decided to have her read to him. There's this book. I think Oswald Chambers is the one that writes it. It's called A Purpose-Driven Life. Rick Warren. Rick Warren wrote A Purpose-Driven Life. And she started reading to him. And this guy is like, God has a purpose for me. And then God used her. There was a movie about it, but the movie doesn't do justice to what really happened, is what I heard. And so
but it's a true story, that this guy became a believer and he ended up turning himself in to the authorities and then went back to prison for what he had done. The thing that caught his attention, if I understood the story correct, of what happened, is that God has a purpose for me. I'm a prisoner who ran away and I have you as a hostage. A purpose-driven life. Did you know that there's a purpose for you? Your purpose and my purpose in life is not just to eat, drink, sleep, wake up, do it all over again, have fun, do this, do that, and whatever. Get married, have kids, have a career. That is important and essential things of life that God has for us. But he says there's another purpose, and that is there's many, many things to apply if you want to know God's will in your life, but there's some generic stuff that applies to every believer. And he says God's purpose for you in your life is that you are for him, that you live for God. Do you live that purpose in your life? How are we doing on that? You know, if someone was to ask you today, or forget it, if God was to ask you today, hey, who are you living for right now? Is it living for me, what I want to accomplish? I want to get, you know, past this, I want to pass that. Or is it I'm living for him, and while I'm living for him, I am fulfilling his purpose in my life in this season, whether that be college, whether that be high school, whether that be junior high, whether that be working at my job, whatever it is. But my purpose is for him. And while I'm doing that purpose, as I'm living for him, I'm doing these things because it's still for him. And so here he's saying, listen, God the Father has your life in his hand. And he could turn it off in a second. There's no warnings. There's nothing that would have to happen. We heard this story this morning, a real story that happened, I think, this past week. One lady had a surgery, and 3 days later, right after surgery, 3 days later, her husband, and I'm going to share the story because I'd like you guys to pray for them. This is someone in our church, someone's family someone from our church. They're in Egypt. So this lady's husband went and didn't feel good 3 days after her surgery. So they called a doctor. And the doctor came and said, nope, he's fine. Give him an injection. Said he's fine. The doctor went down the building, got into his car, and halfway through the street, the husband dropped dead. Life can end just like that. And can you imagine this poor lady recovering from surgery, and then her husband dies out of nowhere, with good health, just boom. Our life is in God's hand, and we're going to have to give an account. You know, the story that Jesus says, that he says, listen, rich man, you who made it big and you have all these plans. He says, I'm going to, you know, take these storage places down. I'm going to get bigger and I have things that will last me. I have retirement. I have all the, I'm going to live my life. He says, you fool. This, your life, will be asked of you. Well, no big deal. It's going to be asked of all of us. He says, no, but it's going to happen today. All these things that you have prepared, who are you leaving it for? What account are you going to give for yourself? Did you live for me? Or did you live for yourself? And so here he says, listen, don't let knowledge take you so far, make you so proud, make you so arrogant. I know the word of God. Boo-hoo. Do you live the word of God? Are you living for your purpose? And do you share the word of God with others in love? Have you been a tool? Have you been a blessing to someone in their life? Because if not, what useless. That your word of God has not been useful in your life, even though it's a useful word. Yet you didn't apply it in a useful way in your life. He says, listen, God, you are alive because of him, and he created you for him. Are you living for him or not? Verse 6, yet for us there is one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we for him. And one Lord, Jesus Christ. But there's also Jesus Christ, and he's the Lord. And he says, I want you to know about him, through whom are all things. That anything that becomes possible in your life, any time that you were stuck, And God came right through, like Johnny shared with us. That was Jesus, because he knew what you were going through, and he was there for you as your older brother to intervene for you. And that's why through him, all these things. Think of how many ruts you were in, and he delivered you out of it. Imagine how many things that God has saved you from it. I'll tell you guys a story. I don't know if my wife would want me to share it or not, but I feel on my heart that I want to share it. A few days ago, my wife was going on her lunch break in her car and was driving to get lunch and to do some stuff at the store. And then a car went behind her, a civilian car, with three men in it, and they put lights. So they put police lights. It's a civilian car. So they put these lights, and so she's like, oh, this is weird. So they stopped her. One of the guys was dressed like a police officer, but instead of navy blue, it's black. So he walks up, and three men walk up there. But to kind of do the surprise, the police-looking guy, went on her side, and then the other two guys went on the other side, and they were looking into her car the entire time. So she locked the car and opened just a little bit and says, what are you guys, are you a police officer? What's going on? And luckily, she was able to, like, not open to them or anything. And they're like, oh, we're just, I want to make sure you're driving safely, you're not driving fast. And then they get into the car. And they ended up following her the entire way to the store that she was going to. And then when she went to a pretty public place, they left. She texted me. But one of the things in the text that really touched me is that these people are bogus. They're not police officers. They were probably trying to hurt her and do something bad to her. And it was God who delivered her. She said, God intervened for me two times. And that man, that was like, when I was at work, that really touched me a lot. I was like, this is someone who really knows God and knows that God comes right through. She said, I was almost kidnapped when I was six. And this is the second time. And she recognized that this was not a true thing. Do you know that every time something bad was supposed to happen to you and it didn't, it's because Jesus was watching over you? And one verse that Johnny was sharing with us that really touched me, he says he doesn't help angels out, but he does with us. That's huge. Because, I'll tell you, do you know how many sins angels have done? Do you guys know how many, how often do the angels sin, per day? Let's take a guess. How many sins per day? None. Never sinned. Okay, let's talk about you, all right? And me. How often do we sin? Once a month? Yeah. Once a year? I'm like talking, I don't know how many times in a day, we all do. There's not a person out there that I'm aware of that doesn't sin daily. And if they think they don't sin daily, they should read 1 John chapter 1. And it says that if we say we don't sin, we are liars and the truth is not in us. You're a fake. You're lying to yourself and to everybody else. So we as sinners, angels don't sin. He says he doesn't help them out, but he helps us out. I don't know if that melts your heart or not, but it melts mine. Wow, Lord, really? And I'm like sinning sometimes deliberately against you, knowing what I'm doing I shouldn't be doing, and I still do it anyways. And yeah, he still intervenes and comes through. Everything is through him. Every time he saved you, it was him watching out for you as your older brother, as Johnny shared with us. And so here he says, listen, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we live. Again, he gets, listen, you need to know your life is through whom we live, meaning without him, you're not alive anymore. Your life can end right now. He's saying, I'm not trying to scare you, but I'm trying to ask you, what are you living for? What are you doing? What are you wasting your time doing in your life? Are you just hanging your hat that you have some knowledge? He says, that's not balanced. You need your knowledge to be balanced with love so you can be a blessing to others. But you need to also live with a purpose, and that is for him. When you meet someone, you meet that someone for him. You look at, Lord, what do you want me to do with this person? How do you want me to talk to this person? How do you want me to react to this person, whether they're attacking you or speaking to you in a kind way? But Lord, how am I supposed to live for you? Because my life, the reason I'm alive is because you're allowing me to be alive. I don't want to waste it.
I want to live for you and I want to honor you with my life. However, there is not in everyone that knowledge. He says, let's back up to the whole knowledge thing. That knowledge that you have, not everyone has that knowledge. Not everyone is at that level yet. For some, with consciousness of the idol, until now, eat it as a thing offered to an idol. You need to know that some of the other Christians around you, now this is very applicable in those days, they were idol worshippers. Maybe they came to Christ last week. And you're coming and eating some meat because you know what you know is true. To them, and to them they're like, oh, their conscience hurts. Conscience says, this feels wrong. That is the idol I worshipped last week. And that's how I ate that food. And now I just can't do it. I feel like I'm sinning against God. It is a thing offered to an idol. And their conscience being weak. Yes, their conscience is weak. They don't have enough knowledge yet. You have the knowledge, but they don't. What are they having them being defiled? They're actually sinning. I thought you said there's no other God. Yes, there is no other God. But because they're doing it out of guilt and knowing that it is wrong in their eyes, guess what it's called? You know what sin is? To miss the target. That's what sin is. It's used in archery. If you miss the target, that's called you've sinned. He says, listen. If you are doing, so what's missed the target? You're doing what you think is wrong. That equals what? Sin. So if you have knowledge, you're eating that piece of meat. Are you sinning? Because you're not sinning. Because you know there's no other God. But me, who's someone who worshipped idols last week and I just came to Christ and I'm eating it and I'm feeling guilty, guess what? Have I sinned or not? Yes. Does it count as sin to God? Yes. Why? Because I know to me that seems wrong and I'm still doing it. That equals what? Sin. He's like, ah. So what do you do, believers? Because you know there's nothing wrong with that piece of meat, but you know that that brother is stumbled, is defiled because of what you're doing, and they join you in doing it because they look up to you. What do you do, believers? He says, well, before I go any further and give you advice, I want you to know something really important. But food does not commend us to God. For neither if we eat are we the better, nor if we do not eat are we the worse. He says, listen, let's talk just nutritional value, true food. If you eat something, do you suddenly feel like, wow, I ate this thing or I drank this smoothie, now I feel really close to God? Do you ever feel like that? Anyone here feel like that? Okay, good, because if not, we'll have to talk after. It doesn't. Okay, how about, do you feel like, oh, I ate this piece of steak and I just feel really far from God now? Did the steak do that to you? You might be really far from God, but it's not because of the steak. It's because maybe you did something or you thought something that you shouldn't be thinking, right? But it's not the piece of steak. It's not the food. He says, listen, nutrition, food, if you eat a lot of it, it doesn't get you closer to God. And if you eat a lot, it doesn't get you closer to God. If you say, I'm not going to eat, you're not going to be further from God, and if you're not going to be closer to God. It doesn't do anything to you when it has to do with God. It might make you fat. It might make you skinny. You know, if you stop eating, you might have some diseases and things, and you get sick. But it has nothing to do with your spiritual life. It doesn't get you closer or further from God. He says, so with that knowledge, you know that food is not what your life is about. So let's go to the next step. But beware, lest somehow this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to those who are weak. So who is really the one who is free? Liberty means freedom. Who's free and who's the one who's really a slave? Okay, so you are the one who says, there's no such thing as an idol. This piece of steak is really not a sacrifice to an idol. And I say, no, it's an idol. I can't. I feel guilty about. Who's free in Christ and who is the one who's really chained and tied up? Come on, be honest. Huh? The first person is what? Is free or the one? Is free, liberty, right? How about me?
I'm tied up. I'm chained with things. Why? Because I don't have the knowledge. I don't know enough in the Word of God in order to understand that it is. He says, listen, remember liberty. But he says, I'm going to talk to you more specifically about it at the end of chapter 10. But liberty has to be balanced. Liberty has to be balanced with responsibility. You can't just do whatever you want to do just because you know for sure it's right and it is right. You have to what? Look out for others, especially others who look up to you and who are watching you. You have to be very careful how you use that liberty. And he says, listen, what you're doing is this person got defiled in verse 7 and verse 9. He says, they are stumbling. They're tripping up in their walk. They can't move forward in their walk with God. Beware lest somehow this liberty, you abuse it. That's abuse of the liberty. That's not balanced. The freedom that you have in Christ. If yours become a stumbling block to those who are weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple. So they see you. You've got knowledge. You know there's nothing wrong with it. And you're eating in an idol's temple. Now, I just want to be clear. Eating in an idol's temple doesn't mean that you're going there and you're like, and watching their worship as they're worshiping. He's talking about like, if you go and you happen to be there, when would this happen? Say you're invited to a wedding. If you're invited to a wedding, I was invited to a wedding once that is non-Christian. And basically, this particular religion, they worship a lot of idols. And so they were doing all their thing, and the priest who was officiating it was a really long sermon. And then, so you know, I was asking the guy, like, oh, do you understand what he's speaking? He's like, no, they speak different language. It's not even our language. So no one knows anything. And he keeps going on and on and on. And they're doing, like, all these things. And I was like, what's he doing? He's like, well, he's kind of, like, preparing and, you know, doing, like, basically some spiritual sacrifice thingy. He's like, so you happen to be there. You got invited to the wedding. You went to the wedding. There's really no other God. You don't really believe in what they believe in. You don't think what they do or anything like that is real at all. It's not a true God. So you eat. But you happen to have some other guy with you who sees you doing this, eating in an idol's temple. Will not the conscience of him who is weak be emboldened to eat those things offered? I'm like, okay, well, if you're doing it, I must do it because you're the kind of my spiritual leader. I look up to you. They're emboldened. They're not feeling comfortable, but there's now pushing them to do it. And because of your knowledge, shall the weak brother perish? And here he's not talking about eternal condemnation. He's saying that perish here means not lack of being, but it means lack of well-being. They're going to feel guilty. They're not going to feel good. They're going to go home sad, and you feel okay because you ate your piece of meat. Remember, meat doesn't get you closer to God or further from God. And you're like, huh, you use this liberty, and they perish. And he says, I want you to know something. For whom Christ died. Are they a weak believer? Yes. But do you know who loves them? Christ. You know how much he loved them? The same as he loved you. He died for them. He's like, this is personal. It's not about your liberty. You've actually now have sinned against Christ because you don't care about this one who doesn't know what they're doing. But when you thus sin against the brethren, he's like, what you're doing is sin, my friend, my brother, and wound their weak conscience. Is it weak? Yes. He acknowledges it's weak. And you're wounding them. You're just stabbing at them. You sin against Christ. You're not just sinning against them, but you're also sinning against, you're hurting Christ's heart, whom you love, and who you want to know, and you have knowledge, but it's not balanced in the way that you're doing it. Therefore, Paul says, I'm going to make a commitment to myself, a conclusion. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, he's not even talking about meat now. He's like, food, period. If it makes my brother stumble, I will never again eat meat. Why, Paul? Lest I make my brother stumble. I'm going to balance my knowledge with love. I'm going to balance it.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to use it as a tool, no longer as a weapon. I want to be a blessing to people. I want to be there for people. I want to look out for people. Now, I want to clarify something really important. If you have knowledge, it should never end with you. It has to be shared. The Lord doesn't want the weak person with the weak conscience to be weak forever. And guess what? You know who happens to be in their life? You. You know why? On purpose. Because God sees that you would be the best blessing to this person in their life. So be a blessing to them. Now, I want to also clarify something else. So you're supposed to share with them and try to encourage them, but in a loving way and patience, because they don't grow up like really fast. You don't have a child who's, you know, less than 6 months old. Let's say a child that's 1 month old. You're not going to expect them to eat steak. Why? Many reasons. One minor one is they don't have any teeth. You need to be able to chew, right? And it's not healthy at that age. You have to wait, and they get to like being a year old. Now they kind of like got enough teeth. Now they can chew, and you can give them something a little more chewy. You could start a little bit earlier, but there's a time that it's just not time for that. But the other thing that we have to understand really importantly is this is not about essential things. Essential things, you have to really teach the knowledge and be there for that person. You can't just let someone be living and wrong, be like, oh, you know, I'm going to have patience because this person keeps using profanity. No. Or this person keeps, you know, having sexual immorality. No, you're supposed to be there for them. But again, in a loving way, God has put you in this person's life. Not blatant sin. There's no sin here. It's just meat. So when it comes to things that are not essential, so now to apply it to the movie theater, what is the right answer? The right answer is what you, by your knowledge, you guys know, and I agree with you, that it's not the building, it's what's being played in the building that matters. But if you have a brother with you who thinks the theater is wrong, and I don't care, the holiest movie is being played, I don't think you should go to that movie theater with that brother. Or advertise to that brother like, oh, I went to that movie theater with that. You're going to stumble them, right? You want to go there alone. You don't need to tell the whole world, but also don't go to the movie theater to watch things you shouldn't be watching, right? If you have a brother who thinks that a sip of alcohol equals sin, don't sip alcohol. Why? Because I'm telling you, drinking that sip or not, it's not going to get you closer to God. So it's not essential in you, in your life. It doesn't have to happen right now. It can wait. You have to be balanced and look at people and in their life. And if we understand this, this knowledge makes us want to grow more in God and know more. But then it makes us want to be so balanced in how we use this knowledge that we become a blessing to people. And then we get people to run with us and grow with us. And we become a blessing. And they become knowledgeable, but they don't become knowledgeable with puffed up heads. They become knowledgeable just like you, with humility, understanding the goodness of God and using love, that they become a blessing to someone else, and then it goes on from generation to generation. And even in the same generation, the same group of people that attend the same church start to mature together and grow together, and then you get more immature that come in, and then we become a blessing to them. You have a much bigger sample of people that can be a blessing to people and continue to be a blessing. My challenge to us, and I'm going to end. Do you have knowledge or not? If not, not an excuse. We must have knowledge. How do I get knowledge? There's no shortcuts. It takes time. It takes reading the Word of God, period. Don't expect to get it the first time. Not the second time, not the tenth time. Keep reading. But take that knowledge. If you have knowledge, and God has put you in the life of somebody who doesn't have as much knowledge, do you have love with your knowledge? And if you do, amen. God is going to use you as a huge blessing to people. Let those who have more knowledge than you, with the love that they have, help you grow. But you also use the knowledge that you have, with the love that you have, help others who are weaker than you, help take them along with you and make them grow. But also take this tool to apply it to things as we face things that may not be documented clearly in the Bible. But you're like, you know what? I can apply this to that and just look at it logically, see what it is, and then look, will it stumble a brother or not? And if it does, then you know what to do. Stay away from it. Let's spend a couple of minutes in prayer, and if anyone wants to pray out loud, open time.
Father, we thank you for this time that you've given us, and we thank you for your word, that there's so much treasure in there. Help us look at it as a treasure that we want to discover, we look for, we're hungry for. But help us as we read your word, that we read it in light and through the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may understand what it is that you want to share with us from it. We pray that we don't take this and hide it for ourselves. We pray that you would help us use it constructively to edify in a loving way those whom you put in our lives. We pray for a blessing upon these words, and that you would bring fruit from them in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.